Welcome to The Agenda with me, Lasha Kingsley Ndwala Cameroon. On today's edition of the program, we are discussing humanitarian works. And joining us live from London on the program today is the CEO and founder of Dele Singa Foundation. I'll be right back after this. Delphine Singer, thank you so much for joining us on this edition of The Agenda. Glad to have you, Mother.
Hi, Mr. Lasha. It's a privilege and an honor for me to be part of your program. And I'm happy that you think my work is worthwhile and you think it's a good thing to share to the world. It's an honor for me, like I said. Thank you.
Can you tell us more about yourself, probably your educational, professional, and social backgrounds before we dive into serious business?
Hi viewers, hi everybody listening and watching. My name is Dele Singa, actually, aka Dele Singa. I am a Cameroonian-born UK-based influencer, media personality, counselor, matchmaker, and of course, philanthropist. I was born in Banso, raised in Mankom Town, and originally from Mobo Division, precisely. I am second of four kids, and it's a lot about me. Maybe we'll find out in the course of the show.
Okay. And you are the CEO of Dele Singa Foundation, a charity organization you founded in 2013. And just let me understand the motive behind the creation of this organization.
All right. So Dele Singa Foundation is a UK-based organization with charitable objectives, first of all, with beneficiaries in Cameroon. So we are targeting the vulnerable and disadvantaged persons, okay, which of course include orphans from the privileged children, widows, IDPs, prisoners, and etc. Okay, so this foundation started by me. It's a vision that God placed in my heart. It's purpose for me. Okay.
Right on.
So it's a vision that God placed in my heart. It's a purpose for me. Originally, I would say that I grew up as a vulnerable and disadvantaged child. Okay, so I have lived firsthand like these children, like these people. So the vision was birthed from there. I had firsthand experience, and of course that translates to my purpose, which God actually gave me. So when God calls you, He equips you through maybe experience the experience of others, His word, and other things. So yeah, that's it.
Recently
I do this first of all for purpose and then experience.
Recently, like these people. Recently, you launched an operation, Feed the Nation, which targeted three regions of the country, notably the northwest, southwest, and the littoral regions of Cameroon. And the operation targeted some widows, internally displaced persons of the Anglophone crisis. Can you tell us more about this operation, Feed the Nation?
Operation Feed the Nation was an initiative that I came up with. Okay, so it wasn't just limited to Dele Singa Foundation. It was also in partnership with Dele Smart Shops and Dele TV. So there's this following I have, especially on the media, and they came together and said, you know what, we want to reach out to the community. And usually other organizations take December and January as that time where they give out. But we thought, you know what, after December, January, February, March, those are the very months where there's peak of hunger and need. So we targeted those months and said we're going to reach out. Initially, it was to reach out to every region in Cameroon, but the funds did not permit us to do that. So what we got at the end of the day did not suffice. So we just limited it to these three different regions. Bamenda, Bora, and Douala. So we targeted those because those are the highest regions as far as the crisis is concerned.
Okay, apparently there are thousands of internally displaced persons in other regions of the country other than these three regions that you visited. Are you thinking of taking the operation to other regions of the country? And if yes, how soon should those in need expect you in those regions of the country?
Yes, of course, like I said, like I mentioned initially, it was an operation Feed the Nation. So it was from north to south, west to east, like that, the entire 10 regions of Cameroon. But we put some funds together and we thought, you know what, it's not going to suffice, that every other person cannot benefit from that. So yeah, initially it was that. We are going to be targeting the central region, the western region, sorry, I beg your pardon, eastern region, the other regions that we've not touched in the course of the year, of course. So it is not just limited to this particular region. But like I said, we limited it to Douala, Bamenda, and Boya because, first of all, for the funds, and also these three regions are those that have experienced the highest influx of IDPs and the worst heat zone as far as the crisis is concerned.
Okay. And apparently,
so yes, we will be reaching out to other regions and very soon, subsequently.
Yeah, shortly after the outreach in Bonaberi, Douala, many people have called to express their wish for you to come to their aid, especially some IDPs who are living in precarious situations in some neighborhood here in the nation's economic capital, Douala.
Right. Yes, Bali Singer Foundation is very much aware that there's a lot of IDPs and so many people in other regions, Douala, of course. Yes, we're looking at what we do, we take our time to vet and get the right persons who need this help, because it's a lot of scam going on now. People coming up to say they are IDPs, people coming up with loads of fake profiles to tell us, oh, they need help and all of these. So our team do the best, the maximum, just to get the right person. So like I said, we vet these persons, we prioritize the need, because it is not just about people needing help. We look at those who are the worst hit. Okay, emergency situations, and we get there. So of course, these people can reach out to us. Okay, we have our numbers on our Facebook platforms, and they can reach out to us, and we will go there. Our team goes there and analyze the situation, and we take it from there. So yes,
okay,
they shouldn't fail. Okay, we're gonna get to them.
Talking about analyzing the situation, I'm just eager to ask you the criteria that you use in selecting your beneficiaries or those who are eligible to benefit.
We have a team of volunteers. We have a team of workers and volunteers, okay? So literally what we do, we keep our numbers open. These people call, those who I meet, they reach out to us through our Facebook page. We have an office in Bamenda. So literally they call us, through the phone, or they write to us. When they write, they explain their situations. For those who are maybe those regions that we cannot get through to them, we ask for a video version of what they're talking about. So they would say, and that serves as a proof, you know, for us to go on. And also, our team of volunteers, they go down to these places to see for themselves how critical or how much need our help is needed. So yes, that's what we do. We don't just see them and assume. Just get calls from people and we take it from there. When we get there, we see the situation, we analyze the situation, and like I said, we prioritize, because there are some people who need help, but there are some people who need more help. And so that's how we go about it.
Many people don't know you as a humanitarian, but it is surprisingly you've been operating since 2013. It's only now that many Cameroonians are coming to know of what you have been doing, the largesse of your organization. Why is that?
Indeed. I think we received an influx of calls and messages and mails, more talking about just getting to know about the foundation. And I was taken aback because I've been here doing this for a long time, like you said, 2013. I think, you know, I started at that time when charity organizations it was an activity that had been relegated to the old women, okay, maybe widows and those old women, elderly women who, according to people, had nothing doing and they just looking away to help out. Mm-hmm. So being a young girl, a very tiny young girl at that time, and which, like I said initially, it was a calling for me. I felt like, no, there's a mix-up somewhere. This is what God has got me to do. This is my purpose. I think I have to do this. I started doing that, went into the suburbs, you know. The other day I put a video online and people were amazed by how far I've come. But again, I would say the reason is because there wasn't too much exposure of the things we used to do back then. Now the media has still, everybody has expanded, everybody is putting everything out there and so everybody can see. Back in those days, we did not have that strong, very strong internet like that. When you go to do live videos, you can't. Most of these things were luxury, so you just do them if you have an analog set of camera. You manage with it, you know, very poor images. Sometimes you go, you see the things, do the work, all you can do is just write it down. So many people did not get to see what we were doing. You know, but hey, we have been doing this for a long time. And I'm happy that these people get to see that it is not just something that is happening now, but it comes a long way. So,
Is it also due to the fact that probably you're quite different from your peers who often brandish the activities or what they do online, or they take pictures and spread? Maybe you were reserved. That's more reason why people did not get to know what you were doing since 2013.
I did put it online, but like I said, most people did not even, you know, most people did not really take me seriously. If I get your question right, most people did not take me seriously. Because I was a young girl studying. When I discovered my purpose, you know, realized that this is what God was calling me to do, my primary assignment, and I started talking to people, most people did not relate to it. So even when they saw me doing those things, they just thought, okay, maybe it was a desperate plot to get money from people. Maybe this girl was just trying to get sympathy and all of that. So no, it was out there. I used to put it on the page. If you check the Facebook page, it stems as far back as 2011. But most people, I guess, did not take it seriously until now that I'm beginning to see young girls having starting organizations as such, and you know, like that. So, yeah.
Okay, you equally run a program called Daily Matchup, which has to do with, bringing people into relationship. Can you tell us more about this program that you run? And equally, we know that the rates of divorce is on the rise, especially in Cameroon nowadays. You may equally want to explain to us what is happening, like somebody who is into relationship issues, like a coach.
Yeah, Daily Single Foundation. I mean, Daily Matchup rather. You see, it's all daily all over the place. So Daily Matchup is, I would say, summarily, a relationship hub. So it's everything about relationship. I started off as matchups. We were doing matchups, you know, bringing men and women together, you know, to have long-lasting relationships, of course, leading to marriage and getting into marriage, and we get to do counseling just like that. We make these things sustainable. So, it's been another style of me doing charity works because, of course, I get to, counsel people, reach out to those, the downtrodden, and reach out to the people who are broken, like I said, vulnerable. So it's a melange of charity, counseling, and matchups, and empowerment, all of these things put together. But like I said, primarily it's for relationships and yeah. Divorce rates in Cameroon, based on my own analysis and the figures I've had on the platform, it is really on the rise. Okay, it's too many people getting married for the wrong reasons, and too many people getting married without understanding the concept of marriage, the institution of marriage, and of course that translates to how quick they are to get out of it, of course, which is divorcing and divorce. So yeah, I deal with a lot of these cases on the platform, and exceptional cases, many people bringing up these issues to me. But like I said, primarily it is because of incompatibility with these people coming together. They come together thinking it's all about love, butterflies, and before long they realize that marriage is more than just having feelings for each other. There is more to it than you know, I love you, and that's so yeah. And I have to start teaching, telling them, giving them all the principles and they need, and you know, so that we can have like I said, sustainable relationships. Yeah.
So how much achievements, or let me put it that way, how much feedback you've got since you launched this platform? Are people coming back to thank you for connecting them? Can you just tell us probably the rate of success since you launched this platform of matching people together?
You know, apart from that, we have our website, by the way. So we have, if you go on www.bellysmartjobs.com, you will have, so it's like a service, a relationship, and you get all of these things on there. But most interestingly is the page. So the Facebook page, rather. So the Facebook page has activities, all sorts of activities. We have cases brought to us on a daily, we call them exceptional cases. So these are people in relationship, with relationship issues, wanting solutions to their problems. So yeah, they bring them on the platform, and of course we have feedbacks from these people, the ones I put together who end up of course in Holy Matrimony. They come and they testify on the platform. Yeah, you can go there and you see it. You can get on the review section and you would see the reviews of different persons, of course, on the platform. Okay. So like I said, relationships. So when you come on there, you can do private counseling or public counseling, which is the exceptional cases. You can do match-ups. Okay, you can have there's a brand match-up that you people come on there every first of the month and mingle and see if something comes out of it.
Okay.
So talking about feedback, we have lots of these feedbacks from people who are in relationships and those who have obviously graduated from these relationships into marriage.
Okay, let's go more practical now. Recently, or let me put it today, a newspaper in Cameroon reported that two women fought over a man who is not even their husband, and one had to bite the lips of the other and swallow over a man who is not even, or who was not even their husband. What message do you have for the youths in Cameroon when it comes to relationship?
That's a crazy one. I get that on the platform on the daily. Women fighting other men, women, like I said earlier, it's a lot of people getting into relationships and trying to be called Mrs. and Misters for the wrong reason. And when the foundation of everything is destroyed, there's no how that thing can stand. In the beginning of the year, because I do a lot of teachings as well for young ladies who follow me on the platform, same to men as well, but of course, predominantly young ladies, I tell them that self-love is everything. We have a program for this year, self-love. It's all about self-love, and I have the teaching, so we structure it to teach them every. We have one topic for every month. So
yeah.
By the end of the year, we would have gone through the entire agenda for the year. We would have gone through the entire syllabus for self-love. So coming back to what you asked, I think that when you see women who go about fighting over men, it is just indicative of one thing, self-love, the lack of self-love, the lack of self-esteem. They don't know who they are. So they are looking for men to validate them. They're looking for men to give them a sense of belonging, a sense of reason, so a sense of being. So they think that if I am called a missus, it authenticates me. It makes me feel better. It makes me look responsible. It makes me belong. So they are getting into this for the wrong reasons. And like I said, as much as you cannot have love from another person, it starts from within. If you are messed up inside of you, there's no how another person is going to give you love and you can even appreciate it. So yes, people can give it to you, but how accommodative can you be of that? So it is a lot of young girls, especially, I always insist on the ladies, it's a lot of young women nowadays who would do anything. They get desperate to want to be in a relationship. But I come here to tell them it is a beautiful thing to be in a relationship. It is a beautiful thing to be married. But most importantly, it is even better to have found yourself, know your purpose, understand why you came on earth, discover who you are, your potentials, your strengths, your weaknesses, and all of these things. And a man coming into your life is just a plus. When you know who you are, understand who you are, fall in love with yourself, question yourself, be an empowered version of you. You attract so many of these men, and there's no reason whatsoever you go about fighting with other women. So I think it's just, like I said, women who still don't understand who they are and have a very low self-esteem about them and who go about doing what you've just explained. Yeah.
No, okay, madam. And your last message, apparently we are getting out of the program. The program is coming to an end. Your message to the less privileged, those who are in pains across the national territory. We are talking about the widows and those who have run away from the conflict zones in Cameroon and right now. They need your help, or the help of people like you.
Okay, my message, I think I've given part of the message already to young girls. Of course, they're part of what I've explained already. But most importantly, I need every young girl and every young man listening to me, even the elderly ones as well, because it's never too late to learn. I think I've gotten to a place in life where I think a lot of people look up to me. Some people call me mentors. Some people look up to me for to get their lives better. It never used to be like this. A lot of people watching me know my story. They know where I'm coming from. They know how it was hard for me to navigate through life. They know the battles I fought in life. And even when they do not know, I always take out time to explain these things to them so that they understand life is a journey. And everybody has their lane. It is okay to run your race at your pace. Okay, you're definitely going to get there. And there's a popular saying that life is an express road and overtaking is allowed. It is not about what others are doing. It is not about what people want you to do. It's about what God has called you to do in this life. And it no matter how long it takes, you will eventually get there. I see a lot of young people nowadays, they want .com success. And I am here to tell them that it's not a right route to take, okay? There is still a good thing to sit there and be consistent with what you're doing. Discover your purpose and be consistent, and it's a matter of time the success is going to meet you. So do not take the wrong way. Do not take the easier way, rather. Don't go through that easy path. I was talking about my story. Today I'm a testimony to a lot of young women. Today I'm a testimony to family members, to friends, and the world at large. I need people to understand that if I can get here, and where I'm getting to, because I've not gotten to that place yet, I'm still going there, but it's a lot better, they can do it. And for the IDPs, of course, it is not just, I don't like tagging people, IDPs, I don't like tagging them. We just use this word sometimes just so that we can better explain what's happening. But take yourself off the tag. Being an IDP doesn't mean the world is over for you. Being an IDP doesn't make you any less of a human being. You can still make it happen, okay? So do not put yourself in these places or in very don't put yourself in positions where you would have to compromise, you know, to make life, to make ends meet. You can still take it from there. You can still do it from there, wherever you are, regardless. You can still pick up yourself from there and remember it could have been worse. So I want every IDP listening to me that even when you don't have the help that you thought you would have wanted, people not helping you out, there's a God looking at you. There's a God who is ready to answer you. There's a God who is willing to take you to the next level, okay? If you only believe in Him, it's not about man. It is not about what people will give you. The help we give is only temporal. But if you want sustainable help, that will come from God. So I just need them to be disempowered, to know that they too can do it, to know that they are not the worst. Okay, to know that life, there's still light at the end of the tunnel.
Certainly, madam, you have some people in mind that you might want to address, those who may be interested in pushing, giving you a helping hand to push forth your agenda. What message do you have for them?
Can you say that again, please? What message do I have for?
For those who may want to help you push forth your agenda of helping the less privileged.
Oh, right. I get it. Those who want to help me push the agenda forward. I mean, first of all, thanking those who have been there before now. It's been a lot of people who have been, especially the volunteers. But I sincerely want to thank Mr. Mbu Rene. He is the national coordinator for Delhi Singer Foundation. He has worked tirelessly to see that this foundation gets to the level where it is and having this exposure it's having right now. There's literally no Delhi Singer Foundation without him. I salute you. I want to say thank you to you. My mentor, Jesse Song, Reverend Jesse Song, he bought his vision from inception. When I talked about it to him, he just bought it and he empowered me and put me through, and we have what we have right now. And then especially those who work as volunteers, I do not take you people for granted. It's too many of you that I cannot, it's Delhi Singer Foundation has so grown. It's too many of you that I can't really call the names now, but I just want to say everyone working for us, writing for us, and doing all of these things that you do free of charge, I insist. Okay, they're volunteer workers, we're not paying them. So whatever they get is just maybe food and drinks at the end of the day. So, and that's literally nothing. Thank you so much. And then for those of you who have been sponsoring, yes, primarily I am the main sponsor of the foundation. But hey, I have a lot of people who have every now and then, you know, supported the foundation. I want to say thank you from my heart. Most of you always want to remain anonymous. Thank you so much. And then for potential sponsors, the doors are open. Please come. The need is there. It's too many people out there who need these things. They need you. If you don't need millions to help people, you just need a penny, okay, to start from. So please do not relent. If you want to get through to us, I guess our details are on the screen. But if not, just check us out on Delhi Singer Foundation or Delhi Smart Shops or Delhi TV on social media. And of course, we would be available to talk to you anytime. Thank everyone who has been there supporting me, pushing me forward, encouraging me, sharing my work, and especially you, my Media Prime crew. Thank you so much for having me. I am honored. Thank you.
Delphine Singer, thank you so much for taking time off your busy schedule to talk to my Media Prime Television. It was a pleasure having you, madam.
The pleasure is mine. Thank you so much. Please.
Bye-bye.